And I think we have to congratulate ourselves. It's been quite extraordinary, the weather, and we've even had some of it in Dublin. I'm particularly pleased to welcome you to the second of our talks on contemporary art with contemporary artists in conversation. Now, you may in some ways think that's a bit of a distant place for the National Gallery of Ireland to go. We have a bit of a tradition in the national galleries of the world that we stay clear of contemporary artists in the collection. You usually have to be part of the pantheon, which is a bit long gone. I must say it's very pleasing to see that increasingly national galleries across the world are also engaging in many, many creative and wonderful ways with art being made today. And I think part of that is to live the continuity that if art isn't made, we don't exist. And that is something that we have to carry within our hearts, because artists working today often use museums as their and galleries as their reference points. They often grow up wandering through art galleries, and they often put themselves at some point within the constellation of art being made in all kinds of ways, in all kinds of places, at all kinds of times. We're celebrating our 150th anniversary this year, as you've probably seen, and it's given us an opportunity to look at different ways that art is made. You're probably aware that we have artists on our governing body, which is quite unusual. There are a number of institutions. The Tate, where I used to work, was one of them, but they're not many. And we're showing a selection of works. It opens on Saturday, of artists who have been on our governing body, including James Hand and Martin Gale, who are currently on members of our board. We're also looking at the relationship between the National Gallery and the various institutions that were there at the formation, including, of course, the RHA and the RDS and the RIA and various others. And we'll be looking in a series of talks, I think, towards the later part of spring, of historic artists like Mani Jellett and Sarah Peirce and Sean Keating, who have been members of our board, actually sometimes for not just a few years, but for decades. So we're really looking in some depth at the connections between art, contemporary art, the making of art, and its connections with the National Gallery. And it gives me great, great pleasure to welcome Willie Doherty tonight, who will be in conversation with Declan McGonagle. Declan will introduce Willie in a short while, but I've certainly actually followed both their works over very many years now. Declan, as you probably are aware, is a Turner Prize shortlisted person. He wasn't an artist, but back in the day, before they restricted it to artists, Declan was actually put up there as someone for his curatorial work. And that was, I suppose, roughly the same sort of time that you began to have a familiarity with Willie's work and show his work. And certainly Willie Doherty's work is something that I've been looking at with great and growing admiration for many, many years. And if you've got an opportunity to hop across to the Curling Gallery, it's probably shut now. I know that Ken's here. But go and have a look at the latest work he's made. It's really quite remarkable and was part of a... in a show that happened last year in Derry. But you'll learn more about Willie's work and his way of thinking and his approaches to art in the conversation that is about to take place. So I'm going to clear the way for that now. And just to say, after this evening, there is a glass of wine awaiting all of you upstairs where we all came in the Winter Garden. So many thanks for coming along, for braving the weather. I know why you've come. It's for these two, not for me. So onward and upward. Declan.
Thank you very much, Sean. I'm just going to make a few remarks, really, just to introduce Willie before we move on to Willie's own presentation and then the conversation. Willie, as you can see from the documentation, is one of Ireland's leading artists. He has a considerable international reputation and has exhibited in all the major international and transnational exhibitions and has works in all the significant collections worldwide. He's also a very influential figure, I think, increasingly so, and that comes essentially from the fact that his core subject, in my opinion, and we may discuss this, is actually the mind of the viewer. as much as any of the subject matter that is dealt with in the works themselves. What we bring to the experience, how we have that actual experience of seeing his works, be they still images or moving images, and what we carry away from that experience. Willie's work is situated, but it is not trapped by context. It's situated and comes from a context, but it's not limited to that context. And I think that's really important because his work does not simply articulate the phenomena of, say, the Troubles in terms of our recent history on this island, but draws on a reservoir of meanings, individual and collective, from which those phenomena arise. And in that sense, he is doing no more and no less than artists have done over the millennia, in terms of drawing on a reservoir of meanings and articulating their understandings of those meanings in a way that creates empathy with the viewer, challenges the viewer, but actually connects with the viewer or the reader of the work. And there's a sort of unease in Willie's work, I think, as well, as if saying that what you know is not necessarily reliable. And I think that universal condition which his work touches upon is also why it has such a wide reach beyond Ireland and beyond the specifics of its making. And that gap between being sure about what's going on and being unsure about what is going on in any situation is also part of the significance of the work. There's an expression in Northern Ireland, when people would ask about what was going on in Northern Ireland, and it always seemed terribly complicated, all the different parties and the issues and so forth. And the saying was, if you're not confused, it means you don't understand. And that tension, that sort of duality, is at the heart of Willie's work, both formally in terms of the aesthetic content in relation to the ethical content. And it operates successfully in both those areas. In fact, it actually represents a connection, and I would argue an essential reconnection between the aesthetic and ethical responsibilities of art in this era. I think this can be most clearly seen in the sort of restlessness of the lens in the video works, which pick up on aspects of ubiquitous surveillance in the 21st century world in which we live, and also in the tension between the image and text, which occurs in some of the still photographic works, which I think Willie is going to start his presentation with now. So I'll just call upon Willie to talk to you about a range of his own works, and then we'll pick up the conversation. Willie. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you, Declan. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. I appreciate it, and it's a great honour to be here at the National Gallery, a place that I've enjoyed visiting for many years, so it's nice to be here in this role. Don't have too much time to do this presentation, about 15 or 20 minutes, and I do want to show you a couple of video clips. So I guess we'll get on with it. Really, what I'd like to talk about, or what I'd like to focus on, is a small number of works that highlight, I guess, an enduring interest in landscape that runs throughout the work. And by landscape, I guess, I mean something more akin to ideas around terrain. And I mean that in the strategic sense. And the way in which thinking strategically about the landscape or about terrain opens up ideas about the complexity of relationships around looking and seeing and positioning oneself. And I think that this is actually one of the earliest works that I made. And I think that this is typical of that desire, if you want, within the work. This work attempts, I think, to address something that is beyond the photographic. So the work is both about the material world and the physical world that is visible to the camera, but also about what is invisible, what is not seen. And if I could just quote you from Gene Fisher, who wrote about this work in a text in 1990. And Gene says specifically about this work, "In neither case is it possible to see what is ahead, nor is it possible to penetrate the dense thicket of the one or the blind corner of the other. The legends by the river and to the border give the images a dual reading depending on the position from which one is speaking. Thus, on the one hand, they hold the promise of a passage to freedom, and on the other, precipitate a paralyzing uncertainty regarding what may lie ahead. For the privileged gaze, invisibility is a trap. Seeing here conjures up a paranoid sense of blindness and vulnerability, of being seen without seeing. And I think it's that sense of that kind of duality around seeing and a concern with what is visible and what is invisible that has really concerned me in relation to the landscape. Again, this is quite an early work from 1986, which in some ways does something similar. In that there's quite an ironic juxtaposition, I guess, between the text of the work and the actual image. The text, "We shall never forsake the blue skies of Ulster for the grey mists of an Irish Republic," is, I guess, something that was championed by Dr. Paisley at one time when he was talking about his desire not to be part of the Irish Republic. Anyone who knows Derry will know that the blue skies of Ulster are not visible very often in Derry. So again, I mean, this is something that in some ways the work takes us from a position of something that is quite known and quite visible into something that becomes almost kind of mythical in a way. So it's that kind of concern with that complexity that is something that I've always been intrigued with in terms of how different representations of the landscape collide with each other. This is probably another example of that in the sense that it's another work where the landscape itself is inscribed with meaning. The phrase "the other side" is used kind of quite casually, I think, in the north to describe not just the differences in geography, but the differences in one's religion. But in this case, the confusion or the labyrinth of spatial and kind of political awareness is becomes mixed up, where west is south and east is north. Taking the photograph, I'm actually standing on the east bank of the River Foyle, looking across towards the west bank and to the hills of Donegal in the distance. So it's at times it got where, as Declan was suggesting, it becomes hard to know exactly where you are, spatially or politically. This is a work called The Walls, made shortly after that, but in some ways dealing with a similar kind of sense of displacement, if you want, or the kind of conundrum of space within somewhere like the north. I'm standing within the city walls, looking out towards the area known as the Bogside. So it's this duality of being within and looking without, and the knowing that in some ways your gaze is being returned, and there is a kind of privileged gaze in the position that I occupy in this particular work. So that actually led to a number of works that I made around the walls in Derry, which are, despite their kind of historical nature, in some ways are still quite contested. We haven't been as yet able to consign them to the function of tourism. They still exert quite a hold over how we think about and imagine the city itself. So the text shifting ground in some ways alludes to that possibility of of the place remaining unsettled or continuing to shift, literally the ground shifting beneath our feet. Last Bastion is one of the remaining bastions within the city walls, and I think when I made this photograph, the was at a time when it wasn't possible to walk around the full extent of the walls. That has changed now, but so again, in this work, the relationship between what is inside the walls and what is outside the walls was crucial to me. This is a work that opens up another idea around landscape, and in some ways deals with the notion of the kind of imaginary landscape and the idea of home and what home might be. The photograph is actually taken on top of Muckish Mountain in Donegal, and I know a lot of people from the north talk about breathing the kind of collective sigh of relief when they cross the border and enter Donegal. So I'm kind of interested in that idea that a certain place can become almost again, as Jean Fisher talked about it, a passage to freedom. So there is this kind of transition between one space and another. And I'm also kind of interested in the way in which the idea of the west of Ireland continues to kind of hold that that enthrall for us, that somehow we continue to believe in this kind of sense of an imaginary or mythical sense of unity or freedom, perhaps. And this is actually a work from the collection of the gallery here. Paul Henry's work, Connemara Village, which in some ways perhaps embraces some of those same ideas in terms of how we might look at and understand that work today. The work of Paul Henry occupies that similar kind of space, and that the landscapes that he depicted still represent some kind of ideal or kind of imagined mythical space. And this work, Border Incident, which is made just on the border between Derry and Donegal, in some ways is as much about the green rolling hills in the background, which is, in a way, that same kind of mythical space as it is about the burnt car in the foreground. So in a way, this work brings together those two spaces, the kind of political space and the kind of imaginary kind of mythical space that I think it's possible for us to kind of hold in our head, that we can deal with those two concepts of space quite easily. So I made a number of works in the early 90s around the border, and in some ways these are as much about a kind of history of representing the landscape as they are a document or a record of the roadblocks that were built along the unapproved roads of the border. So for me, the two things are very connected in a way. It may be worth saying something very briefly about my relationship with photography. I'm interested, obviously, in photography, and in some ways, the work started with a dialogue connected to documentary photography or photojournalism, and my sense of how inadequate that was at some way in dealing with the conflict in the north of Ireland. So I suppose I'm working towards a position where I'm both interested in the the fact that the camera or photography can record some evidence of the material world around us, but at the same time, I'm interested in creating work that opens up all our kind of imaginary spaces or all our stories that enable us to see those same spaces in a different kind of way. And for that, I think photography alone is at times inadequate, which in some ways explains the relationship with text and then subsequently the relationship that I developed with working with video, where I use voiceover really as an attempt to replace the text that was in the early work. So all of these works in some ways are related to those ideas of both the documentary and a kind of imagined or a space that has other stories that in some ways exist beyond the visual. This small group of works was made in 1995, 96, which was at the period where the ceasefire in the north of Ireland was in place, but before the Good Friday Agreement was signed. So it was in some ways both a period of kind of optimism, but also a period where there was a degree of instability or uncertainty about the future. So these two particular works, they look at, I suppose, in almost kind of forensic detail at some of the small things that I find within the landscape, pieces of circuit board, and so in some ways, they, as I said, they are about the kind of a recording or a kind of documenting of material evidence, if you want. And I think the word evidence is kind of crucial in this case. But I'm also interested in the kind of unreliability of that same evidence. Which is, you know, maybe something that is even more pertinent in these days, where we're more and more concerned with our kind of security and ideas around surveillance, and it seems in the face of all of that, that photography as a tool becomes even more inadequate. This is a work that was made in 1997, which again I think expresses some of that degree of uncertainty about what may lie ahead. The work is called The Road Ahead, and as you can see, the road ahead is out of focus and slightly soft, and there's a degree of uncertainty about what may lie ahead. The next work I'm going to show you now is a work that actually was made a number of years later, actually 10 years later, 2007. And it's the first of the video works, and I'll show you a work called Ghost Story. I'll show you a clip that's a few minutes long. And in some ways, this work brings together this concern with these roads, this landscape, and begins in a much more clear way to kind of really articulate that sense of unearthing the stories that are embedded within the landscape.
The scene reminded me of the faces in a running crowd that I had once seen on a bright but cold January afternoon. Men and women slipped on icy puddles as they ran for safety. A few, in their panic, ran towards a wire fence, further trapping themselves. As they scaled the fence, a military vehicle drove through it, tossing them into the frosty air. Troops spewed from the back of the vehicle as it screeched to a sudden halt. They raised their rifles and fired indiscriminately into the fleeing crowd. The next day, I walked over the waste ground that was now marked by deep tire tracks and footprints, fixed in low relief and highlighted by a sharp hoar frost. I could find no other traces of the crowd. I returned many times to the same site until another fence was erected and a new building was put in place of the empty, silent reminder. I wondered about what had happened to the pain and terror that had taken place there. Had it been absorbed or filtered into the ground, or was it possible for others to sense it as I did? The narrow streets and alleyways that I walked along became places where this invisible matter could no longer be contained. It seeped out through every crack and fissure in the worn pavements and crumbling walls. Its substance became visible to me in the mossy, damp corners that never seemed to dry out in winter or summer. A viscous secretion oozed from the hidden depths. The smell of ancient mold mingled with the creeping odor of dead flesh. The ground was often slippery underfoot, as if the surface of the road was no longer thick enough to conceal the contents of the tomb that lay beneath the whole city.
I'm going to skip that one, actually, the sake of time. As I was saying, a ghost story really was an attempt to, in some ways, account for the past, or the idea of how do we, what we should remember and what we should forget. I mean, that sense of, as part of the peace conflict and or the peace, the resolution in the north of Ireland, that we, as part of winning the peace, we were collectively asked to, at some level, forget about the past and to move on. And I know that it's difficult to do that in some way. So this body of work was made in 2011, and in some ways it deals with a series of related issues. The work was made in a bog in County Donegal. And I think at the time I was, as many people were, I was aware of the ongoing trauma of the disappeared, of those people who were disappeared in the 1970s and 1980s, many of whom haven't been recovered. And the sense in which the landscape itself, again, is implicated in how we kind of imagine and kind of understand that part of our collective history. So I'm going to show you again just a few minutes of a related video work here called Ancient Ground, which in some ways built on very familiar images of the landscape of the bog and couples that with a voiceover.
I walk these roads every day. The ancient ground. Looking for a sign. Some disturbance. Something shifted, revealed. Given up. Leaking. Black mold. The misery. The loneliness. The darkness. The restless struggle. The elements. The seasons. The passing years. The whispers. The shade. Punishment beyond words. The sin.
I think I'll stop it. There's one more video clip, but I don't think we're going to have time to do that. So I think it's probably better if we move on to the conversation. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks very much, Willie. There's an awful lot there in terms of what you've signalled in a very short period. But could I just start with a general question? What sort of sense do you have of what you want the viewer to take away from the experience of your work? Do you have a, I don't mean a sort of tied down sense, but what is your sense of what you would like them to take away?
Well, I think as you suggested at the outset, I mean, the viewer is very much implicated in these works, in the sense, well, both in the sense that the viewer is implicated in how any artwork is completed and meets an audience, but I mean, I go to a lot of trouble in terms of how the work is installed in the gallery, that the viewer has an experience in front of the work, so that it feels immediate, both in terms of how it's installed and presented in the gallery, and how that then, I guess, impacts on the viewer in terms of insisting on being taken seriously, if you want, or I ask the viewer to kind of pay attention in a way. I mean, I suppose that's, in another sense, one of the reasons why I decided to work with photography at one time is that I had this perhaps misplaced understanding that photography for sure. Sorry about that. I had this sense that photography was a language that was accessible or available in a way, perhaps more so than other visual languages. So I felt that by appropriating photography, in some ways that I might touch on a wider audience. I don't know whether that's necessarily true or not, but that was certainly part of my thinking about using photography at the outset.
Yeah. You actually studied sculpture in Belfast. Yeah. And how did that transformation take place from whatever form the sculpture took to photography and then video as your language?
Well, exactly. I mean, I didn't train as a photographer. I mean, I was studying sculpture, and at the time I was making works that I guess you could talk about as being temporary or impermanent in some way. So I became involved with photography because I needed a way of documenting this work that existed for a day or an afternoon or maybe a little bit longer. But so what I ended up with at the end of one of the years in the course was essentially a box of photographs and several boxes of slides. So it was at that point that I started then thinking more seriously about photography, about the process of using the camera, and started looking at other artists, really artists who were working, I suppose, in at that time kind of conceptual and kind of post-conceptual art, who used photography really as one of the primary kind
of means of
work.
Who would they have been, artists like?
Artists like Ed Ruscha to some extent, John Baldessari, British artists like, well, Hamish Fulton and Richard Long, who were also involved in working in the landscape and using the camera as part of how that work existed. And then British artists like John Hilliard, whose work really examined the formal mechanisms of photography, everything from the position of the camera to things around editing and cropping and exposure. So, and I found that work really fascinating at the time. And I think, you know, that work was shown in The Orchard in the early 80s. So there was a whole body of a photographic work that I was aware of, an artist whose work with photography I became really interested in. So I wasn't at that point particularly interested in photojournalism per se, but I found myself using photography really because I needed to use it as a tool to record the other work that I was making.
But even in the earliest works, I think that there's something very pronounced in the video works, the recent video works, which is a sense of dread, or at least I have that sense of dread, mm-hmm. almost dream and dread. But that wouldn't have been present in Hamish Fulton's work or Richard Long's work in terms of their approach to landscape.
No.
Is that another layer that became a strong element of in your work because of the context that you were working through in the 80s in terms of, and your own sort of life experiences in the 70s in terms of the Troubles and the specific context of Derry?
Well, I mean, I think that definitely contributed to the way my own work was shaped, for sure. Because while I was interested in the work of Hamish Fulton and Richard Long on a kind of formal level and the contribution that they were making to ideas around sculpture and what a sculpture could be. I also found myself at some level feeling kind of irritated by that I mean in the sense that the work that they make or the landscape that they appear to depict was a landscape that existed outside of politics, outside of ideas around in a kind of bubble in a way, you know, outside of politics and the kind of the social realm, and also maybe even outside of economics, although they were kind of both embedded within the art world. So, I mean, it was that kind of sense that I knew those landscapes, but I also didn't think about them in that way, which is a little, partly why I included the image of Paul Henry's work in this presentation, because I have a similar response to that work, you know, that I know those landscapes and I kind of love being in those landscapes and visiting those landscapes, but I can't not think about the other Ireland when I'm in those places. Mm-hmm. So in a way, what I wanted to do then was to take some of the kind of formalism of Hamish Long, for example, and the way in which he
interesting conjunction.
Managed to kind of put them together, of Hamish Fulton, and try and introduce this other kind of reference to the context of the North, and that was where the text came in, because I really felt that the photograph on its own was not enough, but also that the text, I guess, was a kind of reference to a body of a photographic work, as I say, that came out of conceptualism, you know, where text was really a part of that. So I was trying to do kind of various things at that point in the work. So that sense of trying to make strategic decisions to kind of shape the work was something that I was very conscious of as a young artist.
Now the early works are very site-specific, you know, and, yeah. And of course even the later works, anybody who recognises some of the images would understand that they're made in Derry as well, but the early works are very site-specific, but you've also made works to commission in other contexts when you were showing in other cities and so forth. How did you negotiate that compared to the negotiation that you had to undertake in Derry, for instance?
Well, I mean, to address the first part of that, I mean, yes, I agree with you. The early works are very, very site-specific, almost to the point of being parochial in a way, you know. And I mean that in the sense that they kind of depend on a local knowledge, both of the geography and perhaps to some extent of the history of that place. So if you don't really have that access to that information, I imagine that some of those works are quite difficult to read and maybe even opaque. So it kind of, you know, when I look back on it, it kind of astonishes me that people wanted to show the work at the time, you know, because, I mean, I feel they're so kind of tightly kind of woven to the place of their production. I mean, I think that process changed as the work kind of evolved. I mean, after a couple of years, I began to have invitations to show the work in different places. Mm. So I think I kind of both consciously and kind of unconsciously kind of modified how the work looked, I guess, in order to deal with the fact of different audiences encountering the work. So I often kind of thought of it as being like dropping a puddle into a pond, I mean, so, and the kind of ripples that go out. So the closer you are to the work and the kind of context of the work, then the more accessible it is. I mean, the further you go out, then the ripples change in a way by their nature. But I mean, I think audiences who encountered the work in London or Paris or New York, whatever, I mean, many of them may not have had any previous experience of the specifics of the North of Ireland in terms of the politics or the history. But there was obviously enough other things happening within the work to kind of intrigue them in some way.
In terms of a methodology, I know that a lot of the works, and some of which you've shown here, involved a lot of walking about in parts of Derry,
yeah,
and taking photographs and so forth. And I think you'd said at one point that making works in other cities, for instance, that if it was still imagery, that one of the ways you did it was to walk about and try to somehow absorb the context in some way.
Yeah, the process of walking is an integral part of it, I mean, and it's still something that I do. So again, maybe there is a kind of a debt there to both Richard Long and Hamish Fulton, you know, that idea of kind of walking in the landscape with a camera. But yeah, when I have been asked to make work in other places, I approach it very cautiously, really, because one of the initial criticisms I think that I had of photojournalists who came to visit Derry and were working there for a couple of days, and then their photographs were inevitably the ones that made the newspapers and became the most familiar images of that place. I found myself being in the same position, that I would be visiting the city for a couple of days, asked to work on a project and have to come up with something, you know. And I didn't really feel very comfortable with that way of working, because I kind of felt like a kind of art tourist in some ways, you know. So I've tried to avoid that when I can, you know. So the work that I've made in other places usually comes out of a longer kind of investment of kind of being in that place. You know, for example, I lived in Berlin for a year and I made a work at the end of that year, but I didn't really do anything for the first 3 or 4 months, other than kind of get lost and kind of look around and kind of try
absorb
and,
the content.
Yeah, absorb and kind of understand the city, you know. And most recently, I made a work in Kassel in Germany for as part of Document the 13, and that was a work that evolved over a period of about 18 months. So I was able to kind of, you know, ease myself into it and kind of familiarize myself.
Did that involve a lot of research, visits and back and forth?
Well, it did, yeah. And not just in Kassel, but in other parts of Germany, because I had this, the work really kind of started with an idea of wanting to trace the source of a lake in the south of Germany, Starnberger See, which is a lake just south of Munich, and which actually flows through Dachau, the former concentration camp, and then, you know, spreads through the rest of, you know, moves through Germany and joins up with the Danube and becomes part of those great networks of rivers in Europe. So that, you know, that research, if you want, was the kind of start of the work, but it became very specific in the end, and it was shot really in an area within half an hour of the city of Kassel. So it became very much about something quite local there, but it started off with a much kind of bigger idea. But as I say, having the luxury of working on a project over a period of 18 months, you know, made me feel that I wasn't in that kind of position of just coming in somewhere and having a kind of an immediate reaction. And
That was commissioned by Documenta.
Yeah,
in 2012.
Yeah. Well, you know, which was a fantastic show to be part of, and as I say, because it's something that happens every 5 years. You know, they start thinking about the show almost as soon as one ends, they're thinking about the next one. So the artists who are invited, you know, are invited in plenty of time to kind of, you know, allow you to kind of respond in whatever way to the place, you know.
I know that the still imagery involves you taking photographs on your own and walking about, but the video works involve almost a cinematic film crew and a collaborative process, almost with a producer and so forth.
Yeah.
Could you talk a bit about that? Because I think it'd be interesting for people to hear, as it were, you know, the 21st century artist working in terms of the difference between perhaps the way artists worked in the past, although we know that artists were always collaborators,
yeah,
even in the past, you know. So, but it is a difference. You keep that solo process when you're making still images, even now, I think.
Yeah.
And then the larger process with the film crew and so forth for videos.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. I mean, that's essentially how video has evolved, really, in the last 15, 20 years. I mean, the first video work that I made was in 1993, and that involved me driving a car and a friend sitting beside me holding the camera, you know. And then quite a number of the works that I made after that, I made on my own. So it wasn't really until probably 1997 that I realized that in order to kind of begin to make video works of the complexity that I wanted to approach, then I needed to collaborate with a crew. Because in some ways, in what I said about the photographs in terms of positioning was equally true for the video. I mean, a lot of the photographs are about me trying to get the camera into a place that I normally wouldn't have access to, or I'm kind of curious about what a place looks like from that viewpoint or that vantage point. And the same with the video work. I mean, a lot of it is kind of based on the idea of how the camera can move through a space. So a number of the works that I've made recently, the Remains, which is the work that's on the Carolyn Gallery, and Secretion, which is the work for Documenta, and Ghost Story, which we saw a clip of there. I mean, those are kind of based on quite long kind of either tracking shots, or in the case of Ghost Story, Steadicam shots with the camera. So in order to kind of make the camera move as kind of apparently effortlessly as that, it takes a lot of people to kind of make that happen, either by kind of laying down tracks and, you know, or Steadicam operator.
It's cinematic, isn't it? It's the processes
that you
train.
I'm kind of interested in appropriating aspects of cinematic language, both in terms of kind of narrative and storytelling, but also in terms of what the camera does, you know. So I became less kind of interested in a kind of static camera, but more interested in a camera that was kind of moving through space. And that business of kind of something moving through space takes the viewer, if you want, through the space as well, and contributes to the storytelling, so to speak. But that really has become a collaborative process that now involves a crew of maybe 10 to 15 people to make those kind of projects happen. But I mean, in terms of conventional kind of film production or TV production, I mean, that's kind of relatively small still. But in terms of like an artist's production, it's probably
dramatic, yeah.
A little more complex.
In a recent interview, David Hockney said that the first exponent of cinematic lighting was Caravaggio. I don't know if you saw it. In terms of the theatricality and the drama and so forth, you know, are there other reference points in art history that you would pick up on in your work?
In terms of the cinematic, or
well, the cinematic, or even lens-based works, you know, like Holbein, or it could be argued Vermeer.
I think the moment at which artists started to kind of think about using the lens as a means of either assisting with the making of a drawing, or in terms of framing a view, I think at that point, that kind of way of seeing and thinking through the lens becomes something that artists are involved with. And I suppose that's really where you can establish kind of historical links between what contemporary artists are doing in terms of lens-based work, and, you know, the work of someone like Caravaggio. Because, I mean, in a sense, you, with that work, you're very aware of the kind of constructed nature of it. You know, this is not necessarily a kind of naturalistic view. This is something that is composed, it's constructed, and it, in the sense that it's kind of seen through a lens. And I think, you know, that's the nature of the way in which more and more artists are working, you know, the kind of sense that that the image is something that is kind of gained or constructed and made in some way.
Well, it was very present in something like the clawed glass, that idea that you it would be too overwhelming to look at nature directly, so you had to look at it reflected in a mirror with a frame.
Yeah.
That was being framed. It's a very similar process.
I think that the question of framing is something that runs through all of art history. It's something that I think when you come to work with the camera, you know, whether it's a stills camera or a video camera, you're very conscious of what you include and what you leave out, you know, so that the process of framing is crucial. So in that sense, I mean, I think of the work as being very constructed and very composed, you know, which is almost a kind of the opposite of this, of the sense of a kind of fly on the wall photography that or filmmaking, where you kind of, there is this conceit, I guess, that it's kind of naturalistic. Yeah. So I suppose I'm not really kind of interested in the kind of naturalistic in that sense. Mm-hmm. I am more interested in something that is made and something that is constructed.
Well, I think it's very clear in Ghost Story, particularly just in terms of the piece that was shown tonight, in terms of the way you move from a natural environment to then a back lane in Derry. Mm-hmm. And you manage to infuse both, as it were, with that sense of dread and understanding the landscape as not being an innocent space either, yeah, compared to the back lane in, yeah, Derry. And that's almost, I mean, would you say your work sits in that space between nature and culture, or moves back and forth between those two domains?
It moves back and forth. I mean, I think it goes back to, you know, that observation that I made that, you know, there was something about the uncomplicated idea of nature that the work of Richard Long and Hamish Fulton perhaps presents, and my kind of irritation at that started this investigation, if you want. But that's not to say that I'm not interested in the visual and enjoying the possibility of looking at something without thinking about the social political context in which you may have another understanding of it, but I find it difficult to kind of separate all of those things out. Mm. So in the case of the North, I mean, I've heard people talk about this idea that it's very difficult to walk down some streets or to kind of drive through certain parts of the country and not see like a road sign or a street sign and be reminded of an event that happened there in the recent past. So that kind of sense of the landscape being kind of embedded or being contaminated in some way with stories of the past. And in the case of Ghost Story, then trying to kind of reimagine those as a kind of spectral presence. Mm. It's something that, you know, is both part of my imagination, but it's also something that feels quite real for me. Mm. You know, that doesn't seem to me that the space between those two ideas is very large. Mm. And also that it seems very permeable to me, that the two things often kind of meet,
well,
so to speak.
It's landscape as territory, really, and you referred to that at the very beginning in terms of landscape as terrain, which suggests somebody's ownership of it or of its history. There's a very early work, I think you did, which Dorothy Walker donated to Emma, Longing, Lamenting.
Yeah.
Just the blue sky, green grass, longing, lamenting. Which I thought summarized that very eloquently in a sort of shorthand.
Yeah, I mean, I think that kind of language, you know, the language of kind of longing and lamenting is, you know, maybe that's something that is at the core of a lot of this work. I mean, there is a kind of melancholy, I think, sometimes in much of the work, you know, which is possibly an expression of my despair sometimes at what happens, but also a kind of sense of again of the landscape being kind of imbued with a kind of history, both of, you know, the kind of the general sense of history that we all share, but also the personal, you know, And sometimes that feels very palpable to me, you know. So I think, you know, that certainly that is something that perhaps comes across most strongly in the video works where, I mean, I've had the good fortune, again, as part of this collaboration, to kind of work with some very good actors, like Stephen Ray, for example, and who did the voiceover in Ghost Story, and the recent work Remains, the voiceover is read by Adrian Dunbar. You know, so I think, you know, when you work with really good people like that, they really kind of bring something to the project. And, you know, and I think both of those, actors, because of their connections with the North and, you know, and their kind of presence with the kind of larger cultural sphere in Ireland, they understood what the work was about, and they perhaps understood what some of those kind of spaces may have been about. So I think they were able to kind of make a huge contribution to the work.
Well, there can't be any sense of neutrality about their accent because it's placed. I don't mean neutrality in the sense of the divisions in Northern Ireland, but they are site-specific accents as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean,
there's no neutrality even in the voiceover, you know?
No, that's exactly why I asked them to do it.
Yeah.
And I was, you know, again, delighted that they did so. But I mean, I think, you know, the idea of neutrality is kind of an interesting one, because I don't think that this body of work that I've made offers up any kind of neutrality. I mean, I think the work is partial, if you want, and it's about an experience, and it's not about I think, you know, it's sometimes there have been times when the work has been, you know, possibly kind of misread or kind of misconstrued as being about trying to suggest that there is a kind of a neutral space in the kind of politics of the North that an artist can occupy. Mm. I'm kind of not convinced about that. I don't mean that the work attempts to become a kind of propaganda in any way. But I think I would hate to think that it didn't have any position, that it had a kind of bland neutrality, because I mean I think that would be kind of like the worst thing, you know.
So what would you say is your responsibility as an artist in terms of a very dramatic context of conflict, for instance, from within you, within which you worked?
I don't think this is necessarily something for every artist. I mean, I would be really kind of reluctant to kind of propose that, because I mean, I think, you know, that is the fantastic thing about artists making art, is that people make all kinds of art from all different kinds of positions and from all different kinds of contexts, and I respect that freedom hugely, because that's essentially where I speak from. But from my perspective, I mean, as someone who has kind of lived and worked out of the North, I mean, I kind of feel, I don't know if an ethical responsibility is the right way to describe it, but I feel a kind of responsibility to produce work in that context. Because, I mean, I think the voice of the artist is important in a situation that is so divisive, in a place where kind of political language becomes so embedded in a way and becomes so impoverished, that it's often difficult to have another perspective or another voice other than the two kind of mainstream voices, you know. So that kind of politics of kind of opposition in that way is really probably not of much interest to many artists, you know. So I mean, I kind of saw the kind of space or the gap in the context where language itself was so kind of bound up in the conflict, you know. And I'm thinking back to even times of the broadcast media ban, you know, which which existed in the north and in the south as well, where, you know, which was something that was put in place primarily to prevent the voices of a number of proscribed organisations from being on radio and television broadcasts, but inadvertently it constrained the language available to talk about and describe the problem that we were all in the middle of, and also inadvertently constrained the activity of a number of artists and writers. So at that point, I really felt that, well, language itself is really what's at stake here and at the core of this. So it seemed to me that to work as an artist, using language was something that was kind of essential and kind of crucial. You know, in a situation, say, where language itself became so politicized, you know, in terms of what kind of language could be used and who could have access to it, it seemed to me that as an artist, there was a kind of crack there or a kind of gap that you could work within. But as I say, I mean, that's not a position that everyone would seek to adopt, and that's absolutely fine. But it struck me at the time that as someone who was kind of living and working there and trying to raise a family in there, I would prefer to kind of be in a position of trying to do something about it through the work that I was making as an artist, rather than live there and feel as if I was participating in a kind of victimhood.
Okay, I'm just conscious of time, and we do want to have some questions from the floor. So thanks, Willie, for that. Well, can I open it up to the floor? Does anybody want to ask a question?
Okay. Willie, your work to date has been very bleak and dark, probably for obvious reasons, considering the background of where you're brought up. But given the changing social and political thing in the north, and the fact that you're working with young people at the University of Ulster, is there any chance we're going to see some lightness in your work?
Yeah, well, yeah, maybe, you know. I mean, the most recent work that I've made is not particularly cheery. But, I mean, I guess I don't really set out to try and make something that's bleak. You know, maybe that's just a kind of...
The major part of my question was that with the changing system out there, politically and socially, and your work with young people at the University of Ulster,
yeah,
there is a lot of humour in Ulster.
Yeah, there is, for sure. Well, I don't know. I mean, I can't really answer that with any degree of confidence. I mean, I hope so.
You look as if
you
smile.
Yeah, no,
I can tell you he does.
It's not all grim, you know. but no, that's a very good point. I do think a lot about the change in political situation in the north. Sometimes I feel more optimistic about it than others. I mean, it's not been too difficult to feel pessimistic about it over the last couple of years. But I mean, you're right in talking about the young people in the north of Ireland, because I mean, those are the people who are going to shape the future. And I think that, you know, at the moment those young people are being badly served by politics. You know, I'm not a big fan of the politicians in the north, as you might imagine. But, you know, you probably get what you deserve to some extent, as far as that goes. You know, and while the current situation in the north of Ireland is obviously much better than it was a number of years ago, in the sense that the levels of violence appears to have diminished, I mean, I feel that the underlying issues around sectarianism are as strong as ever. And I think there has been a kind of failure to kind of deal with that. I mean, we've seen that kind of recently with the way the potential of what was being proposed in that Haas talks was dodged. You know, so at times, again, I don't feel particularly optimistic about it, but you know, perhaps these things just take much longer than we sometimes have patience for.
Thank you.
But anyway, thank you.
Could I ask if there's anybody smiling in Rembrandt's paintings? Not later on, anyway. Any other questions? Just here first, and then over to you.
2 points. Some years ago, Dermot Ferrisher wrote a series of articles and studies where he spoke about landscape embedding itself in our psyche and identifying us as citizens. And I think your work would very much validate where you come from. And the other thing, there's a sense of loneliness and isolation in some of your images, which would remind me of the works of Edward Hopper and Martin Gale. You've spoken about lens-based artists as your points of reference.
Yeah.
Do you use any painterly artists as points of reference?
Well, I mean, I do love Edward Hopper's work, actually, you know. You know, and obviously there is a connection there with cinema. And so, yeah, I mean, that sense of kind of loneliness, if you want, it's not something that I kind of deliberately set out to do, but I mean, I did make a decision kind of quite early on that I would not put a figure within the work that I wanted to. I didn't want the subject of the work to be the kind of figure within the image, in the way that in many of Hopper's works, you know, although the figures are often located within an interior, and the interior tells us as much about their state of mind as the figure themselves. I kind of decided that I didn't really want to kind of, and this is maybe something to do with my lack of satisfaction with photojournalism, I didn't want to offer up a kind of a figure who might be seen as a kind of perpetrator or a kind of victim in some way within the work. And I was kind of more interested in the viewer of the work in the gallery or in the museum having to deal with that image in their own, in that space, in that time. And the work kind of, in a way, remaining kind of real within that the moment of viewing. And I didn't want that experience to be kind of deferred to another space or another time or a previous time. So that was a very kind of strategic decision on my part to kind of leave the figure out. But I actually do enjoy a lot of figurative painting and a lot of photographs of people and portraits, you know. So I guess, you know, like many artists, I mean, I think you have to kind of, well, I think what artists do is they kind of set the parameters of or the kind of ground rules of what they'll do within the work, you know. And I set some ground rules quite early on, and that was one of them. You know, but having said that, I actually have made some portraits a number of years ago. But to me, those portraits are again, I'm a bit resistant to this kind of idea that somehow the artist can reveal something of the kind of true nature of a person through a portrait. So the portraits that I made were more about the person being a kind of a type, if you want, or a kind of cipher in some way, and not about my ability to kind of see the soul of the sitter. But I mean, I am kind of interested in other artists' representations of the figure, and I'm looking at a lot of paintings, you know, which is something that I've always enjoyed about coming to visit the gallery here. Was that kind of sense of seeing the figure in a kind of painted world, you know, and it's something that I'll continue to enjoy, hopefully, when the
Okay, there was galleries. A question here. If you just wait for the mic.
It's not so much a question as I was very interested in a kind of conundrum that you brought up in the idea of the voice being partisan is probably the wrong word, but not possibly not being neutral. And it came up for me in the two pieces that you showed, one with Stephen Ray, who was clearly from the north, the other, the woman, I didn't recognize her, I didn't know who it was, but she was clearly from the south. Yeah. Are you aware of when you use a voice that, I was wondering, well, why is it a southern woman? Because I was seeing these spaces as the places where people had disappeared, or the places, you know, the places where something terrible had happened, and this person going through. Were you aware of that? I mean, it's a huge area in my head that you've brought up, but just
yeah,
that
no,
question.
Very much. Yeah. I mean, I choose the actors who read the voiceovers very carefully, you know. So. And as I say, I've been pretty lucky in finding the right people, you know. The woman who read the voiceover for Ancient Ground, she's originally from Galway, but she's lived in Derry for like many years. So there's a little bit of both in her accent, you know. So I kind of like that sort of confusion, mm-hmm. you know, because although many of the kind of stories around the kind of disappeared emanate from the north, many of the places where the bodies have been disposed of are in the south. But and I also just had this kind of sense of wanting that voice to be a little bit more, having that kind of ambiguity, but also I like the quality of her voice. There's a sort of, there is something quite mournful about it. She's a woman called Mary Murphy, who is a teacher in a school in Derry, but she's also, I guess, a kind of an amateur actress. But she was.
It's nice to have her named.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Yeah.
Stephen Ray.
Stephen Ray. Yeah. No, I mean, and I knew her. Her voice, because she was often on radio.
It was lovely.
So I knew that it had the right kind of intonation and kind of tone. And also, when I met her and kind of talked to her about what I was trying to do with the work and showed her the script such as it was, I mean, she really had a kind of clear sense of what I was trying to do. So that was really, well, thank you.
Okay, I'm just conscious of time now, so we've got two questions and then we'll leave it at that. So here first.
Thank you. I was just want to ask you about the fact that very few artists from the South actually made any art about the Troubles. Obviously, sort of Michael Farrell, Bobby Ballo, and say Patrick Ireland, Brian O'Doherty, and maybe somebody like Richard Hamilton in England. And I'm just wondering, have you any sort of comment on whether they should have, or whether they were, consider them sort of maybe a bit like what you were saying, afraid to sort of, you know, jump in when you didn't sort of,
yeah,
weren't involved in the process?
Yeah, I mean, there may have been a little bit of that. I mean, perhaps, you know. It's not something that I would kind of recommend for everyone, you know. I think if I hadn't been living in that place, I probably wouldn't have become involved in it, you know. I mean, I think of that, and I think of that really as in the way that an artist kind of lives everywhere. I mean, if you live in Dublin, or you live in London, or you live in New York, in some ways, what's happening outside the kind of doors of your studio, and what's happening on the streets that you walk every day, at some level, it must kind of filter into the work, I think, you know. So for me, that was at some level how it kind of started, that this was stuff that I just couldn't ignore, you know, so that it began to kind of filter much more strongly into the work. I guess that artists from different places feel, you know, different kind of responsibilities, or the kind of urgency, or the kind of desire to kind of say something about, you know, different kind of moments of conflict or whatever. I mean, I think many artists are very cautious about that, because no one wants to kind of make bad art, and no one really wants to kind of make propaganda. And I think often artists kind of struggle to kind of find a method for saying something that kind of feels valid for themselves as an artwork and can't be mistaken for a piece of kind of crass propaganda. But I know, I mean, I know you met a couple of the artists you met. I mean, like Robert Bella, for example. I mean, I think he made some work after the Miami show band shootings, you know. So, I mean, I think it was obviously, and I know that he knew some of those people personally because he was involved in the music business. So I think artists are kind of motivated to do things at certain times for specific reasons or whatever, you know. So I mean, I would never criticize the artist who doesn't do anything, you know. I mean, sometimes I think it'd be quite nice to be like Matisse in the south of France and kind of make those works and, you know, not kind of worry about the rest of the world, you know. But I mean, I think increasingly, I mean, if you look at the work of a lot of contemporary artists at the moment, I mean, I think there are a lot of artists who are making work around broadly what you would call like political or kind of socio-economic issues, you know. So I think maybe it's more prevalent now than it was maybe 5 or 10 years ago. But that's perhaps just the way kind of dynamics shift within the art world at any time.
Okay, just here, second row.
It's just another question related to the videos. I'm assuming that the words are your own, and I was wondering which came first.
I actually shoot the video first, which is the kind of wrong way around, I know. But I mean, I suppose, I mean, that's always been the way that I've worked with the photography. I mean, so out of this process that Declan talked about of going for a walk and taking the camera and making some photographs, I mean, that was always a way in which I kind of made the works that ended up with text. So I didn't have a text in mind. I usually printed up, you know, small versions of the photographs and then started to kind of think about the possibilities of how I might use text with them and what that text might be. So I've kind of ended up doing a similar thing with the videos.
It struck me particularly the last one, where there was constantly changing images, the words just flowed so well.
Yeah, well, I mean, I suppose it becomes a bit like a collage somehow in the end, that, you know, that I have the images and I actually do the editing, so I have control over how I can, you know, really make the edit work with the text. But even in the more complex works, like the work, that ghost story and the work that I made for Documenta, both of which have kind of quite long scripts, if you want. In both of those cases, I shot the footage and then lived with it for a few months before I really kind of understood fully what it was about and was able to then kind of write the text afterwards. It's a slightly kind of high risk strategy sometimes. It feels a bit kind of precarious, but I mean, I think that's the kind of interesting difference between having the luxury of making work like this as an artist and not having the pressures of a kind of a, you know, television or kind of film production situation where the script is kind of like a Bible and everything kind of flows from the script and the kind of visuals kind of flow from that. In this case, it really is about spending time in the location. So it comes back to this kind of idea of the landscape or the kind of location being kind of primary. And I've been kind of lucky enough that I've built a crew of people that I've worked with over the years. So they know that they're not going to get a script. And they know that when we kind of go on a shoot for 3 or 4 days, that we're really just going to be filming a landscape or a number of locations. You know, and I suppose that has been kind of a difficult thing for me and a difficult thing for them, because initially when I kind of started working with these film crews, and these are people who normally work in kind of television or kind of film productions, you know, they didn't really quite know what to expect when I kind of turned up with them and we didn't have a script, and you know, kind of explained what I was trying to do. But it's kind of got to the point now where they kind of trust me and they know that, you know, we can have fun while we're filming the stuff, you know.
Okay, I think we'll draw to a close.
One more, Declan, there.
Sorry.
The last one.
I'm just conscious of the time. That glass of wine is still waiting upstairs.
Thank you very much. I just have one quick question regarding the current exhibition at the Curlin, which I've seen and I loved it. I thought it was a very, very powerful video. I just wondered, would you mind elaborating a tiny little bit on the relationship between the stills and the video? Going up there and seeing the stills in this kind of anteroom situation to the video, I wondered, did it ever... did you consider leaving them out to just leave that room white, or do you feel it an important presence in relation to the video?
I did consider leaving it white, but in the end, I kind of thought it was an interesting thing happens because it if you come up and you see the two photographs first, in a way, they're kind of quite mute. You know, they're not particularly spectacular photographs. And then I think when you go in and you see the work and you come back out and you see them again, they become contaminated then by what you've just seen. So I was kind of interested in that kind of two-way kind of process, how they begin to kind of feed off each other. I made the photographs about somewhere between 4 and 6 months before I made the video. The photographs were part of a project that I was working on with a writer called Susan McKay. We had both been invited to make a project for the Field Day Review, which was being published as part of the Derry City of Culture. So there were a couple of ideas that Susan and I were kind of talking about, and so in the course of making that project, I photographed a number of these locations in and around Derry where there had been a number of paramilitary punishment shootings, both kind of fairly recently, but also kind of historically, because some of these places have been used for 20, 30 years for the same purpose. So it was while working on that article or that project with Susan that I then started to think that I would make a video in the same place. So I didn't know that I was going to make a video when I made the photographs. And same thing applied. We shot the video over 3 days, and then I wrote the script about a month or two after that. But yeah, in the gallery, I mean, I think it would have been a different experience if the photographs weren't there. And I kind of like the way they kind of play off each other.
Okay, we will leave it there. Thank you very much.